So what I'm going to talk about today is what we call solar impact on climate, and the question is whether it is important. If you see here, you see a beautiful picture of the sun, and what you notice is that it's quite dynamical. What you see in these bright spots is what we call solar activity, and it's been speculated for more than 200 years whether changes in solar activity could change the Earth's climate. So it is interesting to look at what the latest report is saying about the solar influence. So if you look here, you can see from 1750 until 2019, from the latest report, you can see there is a large, what we call, forcing from greenhouse gases. But it also states what they think that the effect of the sun is, and you might have difficulty in seeing it, but it is right there. And it is the same as saying that the natural forcing from the sun, and probably more general in general, has had no influence at all. And the reason that they can say this is because they are only looking at solar irradiance. Solar irradiance is just the energy output from the sun, that is how many watts per square meter that is coming out. And these changes are actually quite small. So we can say in the latest report, the changes from solar irradiance is so small, I think it's about 0.05 watts per square meter. So it's so small that it has no effect on climate. So that has been sort of the situation for a long time. And when I started this, it was an attempt to try to understand if there was another way that solar activity can affect climate. And one of the things that we have been working on, and this is the main work, is how cosmic rays affect climate. And cosmic rays, it sounds like some kind of science fiction, but it's actually a real thing. It is something that is penetrating the atmosphere all the time. It is penetrating you. It's a very energetic particles. What you see here is sort of a it's actually from the front page of the geophysical research letters, and it is actually on behalf of one of our latest papers. But what you see is that these cosmic rays coming in, and the idea is that this is actually changing the Earth's cloud cover. And this is this story I want to show you. And it turns out that each time there is a change in cosmic rays, it appears that there is a change in the Earth's climate. So we have tried to understand this connection for a long time. And much to my, or maybe also other surprises, is that this mechanism seems to be working even on longer timescales. And I will just show you very briefly that on long timescales, this mechanism is also operating, which makes which is quite surprising. So what are cosmic rays? Well, if you look here, you can see a schematic of our solar system. You can see here the sun, and then you have the heliosphere. This is where the solar wind is blowing out. And all the planets are within this sphere. And out here you have the cosmic rays, and they try to penetrate into the solar system. And when the sun is active, it can actually it can regulate how many cosmic rays are entering in the top of the atmosphere. So what is happening when they enter the atmosphere? So you imagine you have a very energetic particle coming in. It's typically a proton. And then you get a shower that goes all the way down through the atmosphere. So one particle, because of the interactions, becomes a whole cascade of new particles. And these particles, they are ionizing the atmosphere. They are producing new isotopes, and one of the isotopes is what you know from archaeology. It is carbon 14. Carbon 14 goes into together with oxygen and becomes CO2, and then it gets into trees. And then if you measure how much carbon 14 there is relative to carbon 12, you can actually, by measuring at a different annual ring, you can say how active the sun was at a certain time. So now you can actually reproduce solar activity going back almost 30,000 years by this method. So and it is because you are producing this carbon 14 in the atmosphere. So what you see here is a solar activity over the last about 600 years. Here around 1600, you see the bottom curve here is what we call sunspots. So it is magnetic activity on the sun. These first measurements is actually Galilei that made these measurements, but you can see that there are changes in solar activity. There is this 11-year variations, but there's also variations on longer timescales. But up here, you can see the changes in cosmic rays. So when you have very little solar activity, you get more cosmic rays into the Earth. And you can also see that there has been sort of a decrease in cosmic rays over the last 100 years as the sun's solar activity has increased over this period. So, as I said, each time there is a change in the cosmic rays, there is a change in climate, and this is what I want to show you now. What you see here is data from a cave in Oman where you look at stalagmites, and from the stalagmites you can get some isotopes that are proportional to temperature, and this is what you see here. This is on the order of 3,000 years, and this blue curve is this change that you have, you can say, this climate proxy. And the gray curve up here is changes in the cosmic rays caused by solar activity. And you can see there is a nice correlation between the two. In particular, if you expand this area here around 400 years, you can see the two curves here have very nice correlation. And this is just one example. Another example here is over the last 12,000 years. It is a proxy where you actually look at how many icebergs has moved over the North Atlantic. So what happens is that it melts, and then small stones are falling down in the bottom in the North Atlantic. And then you can measure how many small stones there is, a function of time. And that says something about how many icebergs has been moving over the North Atlantic, and that says something about how climate has changed. And you see there are these oscillations from the present and all the way back. And these changes, you can correlate them with the changes in the cosmic rays or the solar activity, and you can see there is a beautiful correlation. You have the little ice age here, and you had the medieval warm period. What you see is something that has happened many times in the past. There's been changes which seems to be correlated very nicely with solar activity. So you can ask the question, is it really just solar activity, or is it also maybe carbon dioxide, which everybody is focusing on? But if you look at the changes in carbon dioxide from ice cores, you get a curve like this. So you can see that there's actually been more or less constant according to this these data. So CO2 cannot explain what we are seeing. So it makes a case for solar activity. We can go closer to our own period. So this is the last 1,000 years. We have the medieval warm period here around the year 1000. And then you can see that we have the Little Ice Age. And if you correlate that with solar activity, again, which is cosmic rays, you see again that there is a nice correlation between the two curves. It is interesting that in the Little Ice Age you had much more bad weather. You have more severe storms, and you have crops that failed because of bad weather events. And at that time, you thought that it was thought that it has to do with witchcraft. For instance, here around, I think it, King James, the British monarch, he went to, I think, and brought his Danish wife, and they sailed over the North Sea, and they were hit by a very terrible storm. And then they thought that it was because of witchcraft, and it actually meant that the mayor's wife in Helsingør, was accused of witchcraft together with another woman, and in 1590 they were burned at the stake because they, under torture, has confessed that they had used demons to make the weather bad. It's just to say that here you have a situation where the most educated people are doing the most horrible things. So being educated is not a guarantee that you do the right thing, but you shouldn't be surprised. Okay, so the question is, I've shown you some correlations, but we want to quantify what is the effect of the solar impact. Is it just a small thing, or is it a large thing? So what you see here is one way of quantifying the solar activity. It's from 1920 until 2000. And the blue curve is changes in sea level. And the idea is, as energy goes into the ocean, it expands slightly. And when energy goes out and it becomes slightly colder, it contracts. And you can see it expands and contracts very nicely with the solar cycle, which is this red curve. And because of the expansion, you can see how much energy is going in and out of the ocean. And it turns out that it's quite large. It's actually on the order over a solar cycle between 1 and 1.5 watt per square meter. And it's not just the tide gauges that I just showed you. You can see it from satellite data, you can see it from sea surface temperature, and you can see it from the ocean heat content. So you get more or less the same thing. And the interesting thing is that if you measure the solar irradiance, that is the most simple way you could affect climate, it is almost 10 times too small. So you have to have something that amplifies the solar activity. And the idea is, which I've been working on, is that it has to do with clouds. So in summary, there seems to be a significant impact of solar activity on climate. We see it over the last 10,000 years. And the changes are between 1 and 2 degrees. And it's something that we had, I showed you data for over the last 10,000 years, and CO2 cannot explain these variations, so CO2 is not the culprit. And the final thing which is important is that the solar activity is amplified. And this is actually what I've been working on for the last almost 3 decades, trying to understand what is this amplification mechanism. And I think after these 3 decades, we are getting closer and closer to the goal, and things are looking quite consistent. And this is some of the things I want to show you in the following. So how can cosmic rays affect climate? The idea is, what you can see from this satellite picture, is that the Earth is covered by clouds. And clouds are quite important for the energy balance. They cool the Earth with about 30 watts per square meter. There's some uncertainty in the exact number. But anyhow, the idea is that what if cosmic rays can change the Earth's cloudiness? So that was sort of the initial idea that we worked on. And what you see here is the result of one of these early studies where you have here from 1983 until 2006, the red curve is changes in cosmic rays. This is this 11-year cycle. So here we have high solar activity because there are fewer cosmic rays. And the blue curve is low clouds. And you can see there is a nice correlation, so it suggests that there could be such a connection. And this is actually trying to understand what is this connection that we have been pursuing for this long period. So in order to get an idea of the mechanism, we have to look at how clouds are formed. And it turns out that in order to form a cloud, you have to have what we call a cloud condensation nuclei. That is a small particle that is floating in the air, and that provides a surface on which water vapor can condense. So if you have a slight supersaturation of water vapor, it can condense on these cloud condensation nuclei, it grows and becomes a cloud droplet. And cloud droplets is really what you have in low clouds. You can also have ice crystals, but that's another thing. So the question is, how do you produce these cloud condensation nuclei? And the idea, it turns out a lot of them are produced by gases in the atmosphere, which then condenses and become what we call a molecular cluster. This molecular cluster then, during a week of that order, grows sufficiently so it has the size where it can affect and become a cloud condensation nuclei. It has to have a certain size in order to affect clouds. So the idea that we've been working on is that this ionization that comes from space, it produces charges, and the charges help stabilize these molecular clusters, and then the clusters, when they are stabilized, they can then grow and become cloud condensation nuclei. And if you have more ionization, you will have more of these particles, and in the end, more cloud condensation nuclei. So you can regulate the number of cloud condensation nuclei. And if you regulate the cloud condensation nuclei, you are regulating or you affect clouds. And this is what you see in this picture here. It's an artificial way of affecting clouds. But what you see is a satellite picture over the oceans, and you have a region with low clouds, and you can see you have these stripes, and these are ship tracks. So you have a ship that is sailing, and from the engine it's pumping out small aerosols that can function as cloud condensation nuclei. So in these stripes you have more cloud condensation nuclei, and you can see that the clouds are much wider. The cloud droplets are typically smaller. It means that the clouds actually live slightly longer, so you get a more... So if you increase the number of cloud condensation nuclei, you actually increase the cloudiness on the Earth. So this is the main idea. So with it, we've had a sort of a theoretical foundation which we can use to test these things experimentally. And this is what we have done over the last more than 10 years. And we have done it both at DTU, we have done it in Geneva at CERN, we even did it in Aarhus, and we did it also in England in a mine 1.1 kilometers underground. And the idea was to avoid cosmic rays in that case. But anyhow, these experiments all show that there is a mechanism. So we have ionization in our chamber, and what we find is that this ionization actually helps the formation of these small aerosols. So what you see here is one of the first experiments results, where we increase the ionization here, and then we measure how many small aerosols we are producing. And you can see, as we increase the ionization, we get more aerosols. And these type of results has been repeated a number of times, so it's been confirmed that we have a relation where ionization helps the formation of new aerosols. One of the things we found a few years ago was that they are not just helping the stabilization of these small aerosols, they are also helping the growth process. So they make the aerosols actually grow faster. So it means that we have experimentally shown that we can produce new aerosols and they can grow to cloud condensation nuclei. So it looks as if it is something that should be working in the real atmosphere. It turns out that we can actually ask the real Earth if it likes this idea. This is what you see here. So you have to imagine this is the Sun, this is the Earth, and what you're seeing is plasma from the Sun. These are called corona mass ejections. It is a plasma cloud that is thrown out with the solar wind. And this plasma cloud, it works as a shield against cosmic rays. So within a week, you can have a very low cosmic ray count. I can show you how it looks when we measure here on Earth. So this is days in 2003. So you see here, you have a certain level of cosmic rays, and then the Earth is hit by this plasma, and you have a big dip, and then it goes back over a week. So this is all what we call a natural experiment with the whole Earth. We can actually test to see if there is an effect of this on clouds, and this is these results here. And let me just briefly say, here we have the drop in cosmic rays over a week. This is 15 days before and 20 days after. And you see a drop in aerosols. And in here you have three different data sets all showing a drop in the clouds following this drop in cosmic rays. So there seems to be a very nice connection. And the delay here has to do with the time the aerosols need to grow to become cloud condensation nuclei. So the implications of this work, it is that, I mean, this mechanism seems to be consistent with these variations in climate over the last 10,000 years. So it is a possible explanation. What people always ask, what is the effect on the last 100 years? And there are some studies showing that solar forcing over the 20th century might be responsible for nearly 50% of the warming. And this is a work done by Siskin and Shaviv in 2009. And there's a number of other studies that also suggest that the solar activity might have it's part of the reason for some of the warming that we have seen. So it means that the climate sensitivity to CO2 has to be smaller. If you take the direct effect of CO2, you would only get about 1.3 Kelvin increase, and not 2 to 5 Kelvin that you get from all these climate models. So you see that this is some of the implications that people have been talking about, and that's also why this work has been so unpopular. So you can see here, this is from Weekendavisen some time ago. And I should say that there's been an enormous resistance against this, and there's been sort of an orchestrated attempt to get rid of these ideas. And I can just sort of give you a potpourri of many of these headlines have been as a function of time. Cosmic rays are not causing climate change. Cosmic rays add little to climate change. But it doesn't cause climate change. Okay, so it's not important. It's not causing global warming. It's all a myth. And here we take a beating from CERN. That sounds very serious. I mean, the most prestigious scientific institution, and so on. So there are a large number of resistance that has been, I have received over the years. So now I wanted to talk about the last part. I've just shown you that we have this mechanism where solar activity can modulate cosmic rays that comes from our galaxy. So it regulates maybe about 10%. And we saw that there seems to be effect on climate when we talk about from days up to 10,000 years. So we see a very nice correlation, and it's important for the historic climate and of course also for future climate because the sun is still there. But the interesting thing is that here we only have 10% changes, and it's the sun that is modulating the cosmic rays. The cosmic rays on those timescales that come from the galaxy is more or less constant. But if we start to look at the very long timescales, then the situation is completely different. So I don't know if you know, but our solar system is located in the outskirts of the Milky Way. And as a function of time, the solar system is actually orbiting the galactic center. And it takes about 240 million years. And is in this journey, we come in and out of regions where we have more or less cosmic rays, and the variations are no longer 10%, it's several 100% changes. So if this mechanism is working, you might expect that it could also be an independent test, which has nothing to do with solar activity, that there could be an effect on these timescales. And it turns out, to my surprise, I will just show you one simple thing. So the changes in climate are now so large that it actually affect life on Earth. And let's just look, I mean, I can try to reconstruct cosmic rays as we orbit the galactic center, and I could do that from astrophysical data, and I get a result something like this. So this is present, and then we go 500 million years back in time. And what you see here is changes in what we would call the cosmic rays hitting the Earth. But the interesting thing is that now the changes that you have between here and here is on the order of 300%. So these are really large changes. And I will show you that it actually fits very nicely with the changes in climate. So what you see here is an expansion of over the last 200 million years. And what you see is a reconstruction of climate going 200 million years back in time. Each of these dots is a reconstruction of climate, and it's based on this kind of shells. So by measuring the isotope ratio of oxygen 18 and oxygen 16, it says something about the temperature of the ocean when the shell was formed. So by finding these in sediments, you can actually then, by making these measurements, reconstruct what the temperature has been back in time. Now the changes that you see are on the order of 10 degrees, so they are quite large, and much, much larger than anything that we are talking about with respect to global warming. So here we have real global warming over this period. If we look at the effect on the Earth, you can see here for 50 million years ago, we had a very high sea level, and so most of the Europe was underwater, but you don't have any ice sheets. So it was so warm that there was no ice sheets. If we then go closer to our time, we can see that we have now big ice sheets. So here we have a cooling, so the cosmic rays are increasing. I should say the cosmic rays are this red curve here. So as the cosmic rays increases, then around 34 million years ago, Antarctica glaciated. Then you had some ice sheets. Then it actually, some of the ice sheet melted, and then they re-glaciated again. And it all fits fairly nicely. But the temperature changes here are dramatic, and the whole Earth is experiencing quite some changes. So the last part I want to show you is that it has had an enormous effect on life on Earth. What you see here is actually Grand Canyon, and you can see these stripes. This is, it's an old sea bottom that you have here, and then you have sediments coming on top of the sea bottom, and you are closely increasing the height of the sediments. So you can actually say that you can go back in time by going down through these mountains. And the interesting thing is that you can measure this ratio with respect to carbon. It has to do with carbon 12 and carbon 13. These are two stable isotopes. But they can actually be used to say how large a fraction of organic material is in the sediments. So if you know how much the organic material is in the sediment, it says something about how large a biosphere that you had at the time in the oceans. So, and this is something that has been measured not just over the last 500 million years, it's actually been measured, we have these measurements going back 3.5 billion years. So. Let me show you. This is the same picture you've already seen, just in a different way. This is changes in cosmic rays. So all these curves are from different data sets that are producing this change in cosmic rays. And now I can plot something that has nothing to do with the astrophysics, which is this fraction of organic material buried in sediments. And you see this very, very nice correlation between the two. So it suggests that there is a close connection between these climate changes and the cosmic rays over this period of time. I mean, one of the obvious questions is why? And it's not too complicated. It has to do when it's cold, you have much larger temperature differences between equator and pole. That means you have much more circulation in the oceans. If you have more circulation in the oceans, you deliver nutrients to life. And nutrients is extremely important because life is nutrient limited on Earth and been it all during all times. So if we have a high cosmic ray flux, we get more nutrients, we get a larger bioproductivity, and it gives us a larger fraction of organic material buried, and vice versa. A small low cosmic ray flux, we have less circulation of nutrients, you get a smaller fraction of organic material buried. This correlation can actually be extended out to 3.5 billion years. So it's quite remarkable that you have this correlation. So let me conclude. We have seen that variations in cosmic rays, they seem to be as associated with changes in climate. We have very strong empirical evidence nearly on all timescales. So we have very nice correlations. We have a very nice, we have a mechanism which we have evidence from experiments and observations. I just mentioned that solar modulations of climate may have contributed to about 50% of the 20th century warming. It actually just means that the solar activity is part of the warming and probably climate sensitivity. Sorry, what was that? Climate sensitivity is on the small side. And finally, there is these implications, and I've only shown you one thing, the barrel of organic matter. A very interesting thing, when you bury organic matter in sediments, that's the way you get oxygen into the atmosphere. That's how you separate after we have photosynthesis. So you take the carbon and move it down into the sediments, and then you have the oxygen in the atmosphere. So if this is true, then and oxygen is of course very fundamental for the evolution of complex life. So it has really wide implications. Thank you.